1962. These people and these stories. Soho, London strippers form a trade union. But there's cleavage among the rank and file.
Do you think anybody knows enough about business to run a union?
Well, for a lot of the girls in the other clubs, it's not really worth it because a lot of them aren't very good anyhow. If there were some good ones amongst them, it would be worth a while.
But I'm saying that actually running a union involves a lot of paperwork and, you know, negotiations.
Yes.
Do you think anybody knows about this sort of thing?
Not really, no.
Prime Minister, happy day.
Happy day.
Winston Churchill is a shut-in, but friends toast his 88th birthday on television.
I'm grateful that modern science has enabled upon my birthday to receive in this amazing manner their friendly greetings and good wishes.
Yevtushenko, Russia's answer to Bob Dylan, speaks in verse to a new generation of Soviet youth. He's a big hit in the West, but he's a little too revolutionary for the Kremlin. Chinese troops attack India in a border dispute. Will India fight, or will she hold to the principles of nonviolence? Krishna Menon gives India's answer.
We shall not surrender. We shall not negotiate with these people. We shall not negotiate with China. Who will measure us? Until she gets out of our country.
Rudolf Abel is Russia's top spy. We've got him. Gary Powers is our top spy. They've got him. On a bridge in Berlin, east and west, swap prisoners. This boy is not so lucky. He tries to jump the wall. Riddled with bullets, Peter Fechter screams for an hour before the Vopo carry him away. Boxing is legalized murder as Benny Paré is beaten to death in the 12th. And the Vatican, after 2,000 years, names a black saint. This camel will become famous. So will the moody Englishman who rides him. It's Peter O'Toole's first film, Lawrence of Arabia. Sophia Loren becomes an actress, gets an Oscar for Two Women. Betty Davis is Baby Jane. Joan Crawford is scared. Eleanor Roosevelt dies at 78. America loses a first lady. New York loses a first lady, too. Mary Rockefeller divorces Nelson. Richard Milhouse Nixon shoots for governor of California, and he's defeated again. He's leaving politics, and he blames the press.
I lead you. I want you to know, just think how much you're going to be missing. You don't have Nixon to kick around anymore, because, gentlemen, this is my last press conference. Thank you, gentlemen, and good day.
Jack Parr changed the late-night habits of America. Now he bows out.
Please tell me, why don't your friends... What have I ever done? And generally, they say that I have an evangelistic quality that's unnatural. That I have within me evil if I used it. If I wanted to get up, I could be like the fictional characters, whether it's the voice in the crowd or one of those things that were all written about the Huey Longs and about the other people. That I have that quality in my voice and in my nature. I deny that. I'm a really very withdrawn and shy person and wish to be left alone.
John Kennedy has been in the White House for a year now. The man who stumbled at the Bay of Pigs has become a skilled practitioner in the politics of confrontation. In 1962, a new test. Roger Blau, head of U.S. Steel, visits the White House, hands the president a mimeographed press release. The price of steel is going up by $6 a ton. Kennedy is furious. Months ago, he'd asked the steel industry to freeze prices to help fight inflation. The unions have cooperated. The steel companies have not. The president can't order big steel to hold the line, but he can take his case to the nation.
The American people will find it hard, as I do, to accept a situation in which a tiny handful of steel executives, whose pursuit of private power and profit exceeds their sense of public responsibility, can show such utter contempt for the interests of 185 million Americans. The facts of the matter are that there is no justification for an increase in steel prices.
Kennedy puts the prestige of his office on the line and his brother Bobby on the telephone. Within 72 hours, the steel companies back down. They cancel the price increase, and Kennedy tells friends, "My father told me all businessmen are SOBs, but I never believed him until now." Kennedy begins to enjoy being president. His only complaint is that it leaves little time for his children. For Caroline, 5, and John John, 2, there are always horses. And now and then, a daddy to play with him. Kids play with toy helicopters. The Kennedy children ride in real ones. While her husband stays home to take care of business, Jackie flies to Asia to seek new conquests. India and Pakistan trot out the circus, and Jackie and sisterly Radziwill love every minute. Pakistan's dancing horse puts on a good show. He is admired by Jackie and ends up in the presidential stable in Maryland. Camel won't budge. But Jackie is not offended. She promises to come back next time with the president.
I had always heard of Pakistan's proverbial hospitality, and it was even more than I had expected. I hope that with my husband, I will be able to return again soon to this vital and beautiful country.
Black and gold, the flag of Jamaica. For the first time in 400 years, it flies on Jamaican soil as the largest West Indian island tries independence on its own. Here comes Princess Margaret in her Austin, a princess in her princess. That's Lord Soden she's got in tow, trying to earn his keep. The model of Westminster is preserved intact. A black rod gentleman usher performs the ancient parliamentary rite. Margaret, on behalf of her sister, gives up another colony.
My government in the United Kingdom has laid down its responsibilities and has ceased to have any authority in and over Jamaica after more than 300 years.
wants to spoil the party. The bands play, the people dance, the rum flows sweet and free. But the morning after independence will be much like the day before. The sun has set on the once proud British Empire. But the end of colonialism does not automatically usher in prosperity. Thousands of Jamaicans migrate to Britain to join 500,000 of their colored brothers. They come from the West Indies, Africa, and Asia, drawn to Britain, their former motherland. But in 1962, Britain slams the door. The tight little islanders don't want any more blacks. And those immigrants who made it before the deadline learn that discrimination and race prejudice are as much a part of the old world as the new. No use saying it can't happen here. It's happening here. To many a London landlady, Commonwealth citizenship cuts no ice at all.
I mean, we call it friends. We're nothing personal.
Yeah.
But the landlady will only have European.
Or is it really that you...
If you wish to call me a liar, then go ahead and do so. You can have the door slammed in your face. If you don't mind,
scrub off the steps.
Even in the seedier parts of London, black citizens are second-class citizens. They pound the sidewalks looking for flats and jobs. The turndowns may be polite, but they're turndowns just the same.
Good morning. This is Tips Agency here, Mrs. Silverman. I'm turning with reference to your job that you placed with us yesterday. I have with me here a gentleman of 24. He's got experience of accounting to trial balance. Yes, fine. And also, he comes from Barbados. Oh, you filled it. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Fine, well, that one's gone. They come over here full of hope, expecting to find a job. They are given to believe that it will be ready for them once they enter the country. I do my very best. I explain to the employer that they have the qualifications that they are asking for. But I'm afraid that we are up against prejudice.
They don't seem to know the respect of people like we do. You know, they don't seem to have the manners, do they?
10,000 miles from Britain, the University of Mississippi. It's 100 years since Lincoln freed the slaves, and a black man is trying to enroll. James Meredith, grandson of a slave, goes to class with a bodyguard of U.S. Marshals. There have been hundreds of casualties, two deaths, and it takes 27,000 troops to keep peace at Ole Miss. Meredith makes it through a lonely and bitter first semester. He calls a press conference, and everyone wonders whether he will try for a second term.
I have concluded that the Negro should not return to the University of Mississippi. The prospects for him are too unpromising. However, I have decided that I, J.H. Meredith, will register for the second semester.
Prejudice is an old story. Nobody tells it like Malcolm X.
This is American justice.
Yes, sir. That's right.
This is American democracy.
Yes,
and those of you who are familiar with it,
yes,
know that in America, democracy is hypocrisy.
Right.
Now, if I'm wrong, put me in jail.
Right.
But if you can't prove that a democracy is not hypocrisy, then don't put your hands on me.
Right.
Democracy is hypocrisy.
Right.
If democracy means freedom, why aren't our people free?
Right.
If democracy means justice, why don't we have justice?
Right.
If democracy means equality, why don't we have equality?
Right.
20 million black people in this country have been like boys in the white man's house.
Right.
He even calls us boys.
Right.
Don't care how big you get, he calls you boy.
Right.
You can be a professor. To him, you're just another boy.
In 1962, people have leisure to burn and money to burn it with. Sunday is a day of restlessness, a great time to take the kids fishing, if you can find a surviving fish, or to see and be seen at the beach. If you can't find a lake fit to swim in, well, there's always tennis. Or a walk in the woods, where nature's life cycle has not yet succumbed to DDT. Or you can go for a Sunday drive, or go to church. Or you can do both. This is a drive-in church in Garden Grove, California. One of the many attempts to help families pray together and stay together. Blessed are the middle class, for they shall inherit the Oldsmobile. God is not dead. He just took the wrong interchange. Church attendance continues to decline, but most parents manage to get the kids to Sunday school. For a dime or a quarter, they can learn the Ten Commandments, which, who knows, might even come in handy someday.
Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill.
Thou shalt not kill.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Thou shalt not kill adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not kill adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Now, supposing you were to come home some night from school, and you looked, and it wasn't your mother in the kitchen. You had your little neighbor boy's mother. This is not God's plan. Your mommy and daddy must always live together in their home with their boys and their girls or their children. This is God's plan.
And what does God's plan say about the birth control pill? The Catholic Church says it's a mortal sin. The population experts say we're doomed without it. The medical journals say it really works. The manufacturers say it's great for business. And girls who use the pill say...
Very few girls feel free to tell their mother, to tell their father that they're no longer a virgin.
Does the pill encourage the new morality, or merely reduce the risk of the kind of morality we've always practiced?
At our university now, this year, the administration is quite worried because they're about... 7 or 8 girls became pregnant, you know, and they're wondering whether they should teach, especially the youngsters coming in first year, you know, and this never happened before. It was more or less like last year, the Queen of the University had to get married, and this year, the Miss Freshette had to get married.
The drug culture is upon us. Pills that make you thin, relaxed, or sleepy are produced by the billions. One German factory produces a sleeping pill called thalidomide. It is claimed to be so safe, it is sold without prescription. Suddenly, hospitals notice an alarming incidence of malformed birth. A large number of women who took the drug give birth to babies with flippers instead of limbs. In the United States, 2.5 million pills are distributed by doctors before the tragedy is discovered.
Recent events in this country and abroad concerning the effects of a new sedative called thalidomide emphasize again the urgency of providing additional protection to American consumers from harmful or worthless drug products. The United States has the best and the most effective food and drug law of any country in the world. And the alert work of our Food and Drug Administration, and particularly Dr. Francis Kelsey, prevented this particular drug from being distributed commercially in this country. Nevertheless, the drug was given to many patients on an investigational basis.
At least 15,000 Americans take thalidomide. Many ask for abortions. One of them is Mrs. Sherry Finkbein, an Arizona woman who is pregnant. She applies to the courts for permission to terminate her pregnancy. The courts refuse. She flies to Sweden for her abortion. The world is so busy debating the morality of her decision that little is said about the morality which put thalidomide on sale in the first place. Mrs. Finkbein is condemned by churches, but millions rally to her support. One woman's private agony becomes the world's public issue. After she gets her abortion and returns home, Mrs. Finkbein is asked if she has any regrets.
The only regrets I have is that it was made such a public spectacle. I couldn't feel better or more at ease or more content or happier that it's over with and that we've averted a tragedy, a lifetime tragedy for a human being.
About 8,000 thalidomide babies come into the world. A massive effort is launched to devise artificial limbs, to replace the arms and legs that were stunted before birth. Some doctors notice that thalidomide babies are exceptionally beautiful children. They are given special therapy, usually at the expense of guilty governments. They are fitted with ingenious mechanical limbs that will never be adequate substitutes for the arms and legs that the drug deny them. And with the uncomplaining innocence of children who don't yet know they are different, thalidomide children learn to take their first steps. Susie is a normal, healthy child in every respect but one. Malformation of her arms and legs. Bravely to mimic the motions of her nurse. And after many months, she learns to wobble forward an inch at a time. Where the tranquilizer got its widest distribution, 6,000 thalidomide babies are born. 3,000 of them survive. Parents file $1 million damage suits against the companies which distributed the drug. Lawsuits will drag through the courts for years. Thalidomide children will bear the scars all their lives. Of God our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, and our eternal home. Defense planners in the nuclear age have a different kind of shelter in mind. Not the grace of God, but a room in your basement. A few inches of earth and some masonry blocks. It won't shelter from the stormy blast of a nuclear attack, but it's supposed to work against fallout.
But if fallout settles on your food, the food itself isn't harmed.
Civil defense advocates make it sound like a suburban family snuggling in till the snow stops.
You simply remove the fallout particles using everyday methods of food preparation. Peeling, wiping, or washing. Fallout swallowed accidentally with food or in drinking water would do you no immediate harm. If we remember these facts, if we act on them intelligently, we can increase our chances of surviving nuclear attack. And the key to survival is adequate shelter. That's why the federal government has a nationwide shelter program. The goal is adequate fallout shelter space for every man, woman, and child. And this goal can be reached. For with knowledge of radiation, we can face the facts about fallout and take action to protect ourselves against this hazard of the nuclear age.
Reality is different. In New York City, a 50-megaton bomb would snuff out all life within 100 square miles. The consequences are described by Norman Cousins.
If people are going to be in shelters, how do you get around this fact? Well, you get around the fact by stepping up the power of the bombs against them and increasing the number of bombs you use on a city. You can seal a city in. Even if you were to burrow a half mile into the earth, it would be possible to create a canopy of rubble 50, 100 feet high. You could seal the people inside the shelters in your cities so that actually they would entomb themselves.
After a nuclear attack, warns Herman Kahn, the survivors will envy the dead. George Kennan says what most Americans think. Let us at least walk like men, with our heads up, so long as we are permitted to walk at all. In October 1962, the delicate art of brinkmanship. CIA planes have discovered the Russians are building missile bases in Cuba. Kennedy assembles a secret meeting of his advisors to ponder the decision that could lead to nuclear war. They all agree. The missiles must go. Aerial photographs show that the missiles will be ready to launch within weeks. The generals argue for a surgical airstrike. Bobby reminds the president, we're not that kind of people. Kennedy must make his lonely decision. The first step will be a naval blockade. The president goes on television, issues a warning aimed straight at Chairman Khrushchev. It
shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
The blockade is an act of war. 14 Soviet freighters are steaming towards Cuba. The next few hours will be decisive. Suddenly, as they reach the blockade, they stop, turn around, and head for home. But in Cuba, the missiles are still in place. At the United Nations, Adlai Stevenson confronts the Soviet delegate.
All right, sir. Let me ask you one simple question. Do you, Ambassador Zorin, deny that the USSR has placed and is placing medium and intermediate range missiles and sites in Cuba? Yes or no? Don't wait for the translation. Yes or no?
Я не нахожусь в американском судне.
I'm not
I am not in an American courtroom, sir, and therefore I do not wish to answer a question that is put to me in the fashion in which prosecutor does. In due course, sir, you will have your reply.
I'm prepared to wait for my answer until hell freezes over, if that's your decision.
Khrushchev is adamant. Kennedy, he says, is taking the world down the road to nuclear war. He refuses to take the rockets out. More photographs reveal that preparations for launching the weapons have been speeded up. Now Kennedy escalates. The Soviet missiles can wipe out 80 million Americans. Kennedy prepares his last resort, the invasion of Cuba. Kennedy estimates the chances of war is somewhere between 1 in 2 and 1 in 3. He signs the documents authorizing an attack. SAC bombers roll into position awaiting the signal. Then at the last possible moment, Khrushchev backs off.
My fellow citizens, the Soviet missile bases in Cuba are being dismantled. Their missiles and related equipment are being crated, and the fixed installations at these sites are being destroyed.
The deal they made was that Russia would remove the missiles in return for a White House pledge not to invade. Later, President Kennedy comments on life at the brink.
One mistake can make this whole thing blow up, so that one major mistake by either Mr. Khrushchev or by us here. So that's why it's much easier to make speeches about some of the things that we ought to be doing. But I think that anybody who looks at the fatality lists on atomic weapons and realizes that the communists have a completely twisted view of the United States, and if we don't comprehend them, that's what makes life in the 60s hazardous.
It opens, of course, with fireworks and John F. Kennedy in Palm Beach pressing a golden key. That's the start of the Seattle World Fair, the first in a series of international exhibitions that set the amusement style of the decade. The theme is science in the 21st century. But Seattle keeps all the things that make a fair a fair, including, naturally, the musical ride. The fair lasts 6 months and attracts nearly 10 million visitors. What they remember most is the monorail, the piece of the future that is still very much in the future. What the customers remember is the Space Needle, all 608 feet of it. There's a revolving restaurant on top where a plate of salmon costs $6.75. A tribute to the space age that shows a tidy profit. In 1962, the United States is ready to launch a man into Earth orbit. It is John Glenn's turn. The small-town boy from Ohio is about to become a space hero. The Russians have orbited two cosmonauts by now, but the United States is coming up fast. Back in Ohio, the only name they know is John Glenn.
John played football right here on this field. He was captain of his high school team and played center for the college.
I taught John and hundreds of others that our democracy is a priceless heritage, and that we should preserve, protect, and if at all possible, make some contributions to it.
In a way, John has been preparing all his life for his venture into space. As a small boy, his idea of a holiday was a visit to the airport.
This is John's flight record with my comment after his first flight, which was eager to learn, relaxed, alert, and good coordination. He certainly has retained these flight qualities right into outer space.
Godspeed, John Glenn. 5, 4.
He's been training 3 years for this countdown.
1.
Now, after months of agonizing postponements, the Atlas rocket is go.
Roger, the clock is operating. We're underway.
On the way up, Glenn talks to the world.
Roll okay. Won't be long
some spectators can see the vapor trails as the first stage of the rocket separates.
Zero G, and I feel fine. Capsule turning around, and I could see the booster doing turnaround just a couple of hundred yards behind me. It was beautiful. Tape is go. We're standing by for you. Roger. Tape is go, and I am go. Our capsule is in good shape.
Now comes a crucial moment. Instruments and men agree. All systems are still go. Mission Control presses the button that sends John Glenn into orbit. At last, the United States has a man in space.
Oh, that view is tremendous.
After three orbits, Glenn is ready to return.
Roger. Directors are firing. Feels like I'm going back toward Hawaii.
But he gets an ominous request from Mission Control.
We are recommending that the retro package not, I say again, not be jettisoned. Do you read?
This is Friendship 7. Now, what is the reason for this? Do you have any reason, over?
Not at this time.
A warning light has flashed. The capsule heat shield is loose. Glenn's retro package is burning up. It has been kept on to keep the heat shield in place. If it falls off, Glenn will burn up like a meteor. As Friendship 7 slams into the Earth's atmosphere, the heat of re-entry blacks out communication. The world waits in silence for 7 long minutes. And then... is down, and he's safe. A destroyer picks him up, and the adulation begins. Footprints are painted on the spot where he steps on deck. In 4 hours and 55 minutes, he has seen 4 sunsets and become the most popular man in the country. For the first time since Sputnik started the space race, the United States feels second to no one. Norma Jean Baker goes to Hollywood and becomes Marilyn Monroe, one of 1,000 girls seeking happiness through the fantasy of fame. Raised in orphanages, she dreamed of having Clark Gable for a father. Poses for calendar pinup. Gets bit parts. Reviewers and movie moguls notice a bosomy girl with wide, innocent eyes. In Korea, she captures the title of Miss Flamethrower. And the 7th Medical Division decides Marilyn is the girl they would most like to examine. Her studio arranges all kinds of awards.
Marilyn, on behalf of Look Magazine, I'd like to present to you the Look Achievement Award as the most outstanding feminine newcomer of 1952. Congratulations.
Thank you, Lauren. And my thanks to Look Magazine.
In recognition of your sensational rise to stardom in 1952, on behalf of Photoplay Magazine, my congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. Sims. It's a great thrill. And I'm very appreciative to everyone who's made this possible.
Everything is carefully rehearsed. What to say, where to look, when to smile. August the 5th, 1962. Dead of an overdose of sleeping pills. At her home, in bed, one hand on a telephone. 36 years old, 3 marriages, 3 divorces. No children. Her films have grossed $200 million.